and Eddie is also, but and Professor Ming Gi said he might cover the
Okay, thank you, Glenn. Yes, so it's the beginning is, yes, it's slightly philosophical, but the end, it might be the financial part. I'm not sure how interesting it is, but you'll see as I go. So the topic today is, my topic today is the treatment of uncertainty in the foundations of probability. So here, yes, so it's, okay, so it's about game-theoretic probability. So you've heard from Glenn about it, but I will be talking about game-theoretic probability both as a new theory, a new approach to the mathematics of probability, and a new interpretation of probability as well. I think unlike measure-theoretic probability, it's both. Measure-theoretic probability usually is regarded as just the mathematics of probability, and it's compatible with any interpretation. But my impression is that game-theoretic probability also gives some interpretation of probability. So I will start from some big picture. So I think it's we can see the world as modeled by science, as we can roughly divide it into different parts described here. So some small parts, so I have a picture somewhere here. So there are some small parts which are fully probabilized. So we can attach probability to any event in those small parts. So it's, but there are also some parts where we have some complete uncertainty. But we can't, there is no, it's too, we can't say anything about those parts. If it's completely probabilized, its measure-theoretic probability is perfect. It serves, we don't need anything else, it seems. But there is also a gray area between these two parts, and I think this is where game-theoretic probability is useful, maybe essential even. Okay, so we have these three parts, and I think it's so in this partly probabilized world, so some events have probabilities and other events don't have probabilities. And I will try to give some examples of these situations. Okay, so this is, I call it risk and uncertainty. It's like 19 risk. So when we have probabilities, we know the stochastic mechanism. And uncertainty, so here it's complete uncertainty, we don't know anything. But also there is some part where some mixture. Okay, so I will start from the game-theoretic interpretation of probability. So this is some philosophy. I'm not sure Glenn shares it, but yes, let me. Oh, we had some of it in our. So we had a book published in 2001, so Probability and Finance, and one chapter it described some part of this picture. Okay, so here. So in game-theoretic philosophy of probability, we don't interpret individual probabilities. We interpret probabilities en masse. So in this sense, this interpretation is close to the frequentist interpretation. But it's the only common thing between them, probably. In fact, they look to me very different. Okay, so here we are trying to interpret sources of probabilities. So people, yes?
What do you mean by interpreting
en masse? Is
this en masse?
Yeah, so in what sense is interpretation en masse? Oh, it's, okay. So it says we need to observe lots of events before we can attach some probability to those events. So like you have in von Mises' collectives, you don't have just one event. The notion of of a probability attached to one event doesn't make sense. You need, at least you need to imagine some repetition, it seems to me.
But you could imagine a repetition where it's always the same probability. So your way of saying it there raises the question, do you think the frequentist interprets a single probability? Or are they having to interpret a whole bunch of probabilities at once? Is that your meaning?
No, I don't understand.
You said probabilities are interpreted in mass.
Yes.
You mean each probability is interpreted on mass?
No, no, you need to have lots of probabilities which might coincide. Like in formalizes collectives, you attach the same probability to each of a series of events, and then you can... I don't know, but here I'm talking, yes, in game-theoretic probability, I think it will be clear that one event, we are not talking about the probability of one event. We evaluate some sources of probabilities like a scientific theory. Quantum mechanics is a great source of probability. So we can say that the probabilities given by quantum mechanics are correct in some sense. We don't say that the probability of one event is correct. It's just some set of probabilities. Or we have some weather forecaster who predicts the probability of rain for tomorrow. And he or she does it repeatedly many times. And then we can see how well this person is doing, what their performance is. Is it good or it's not so good? So we are trying to interpret some set of probabilities.
So there's one thing I understand, but I'm not sure what it is. What do you mean when you say online? So here's my attachment probabilities to events. And a justification of my attachment to this probability is given by the whole ensemble, or the whole sequence, or the whole history, or the whole pattern of behavior across different repeated experiments. That's one understanding that I understand. And the other interpretation that I don't understand is that you can only attach probabilities to a collection of events. That I'm not sure is that faithful to frequentism.
Probably it would be, maybe I should skip to my example. Let me give you one example when we have some theory which generates probabilities. So if a probability is attached to an event. So here, so this is an example of a source of probabilities. So it's a specific theory, very naive theory of, how hemophilia is inherited in among the human population. So we have some set of people. So for each person, the status with respect to hemophilia is one of three values. It's healthy, carrier, or ill. So there are three possible states. And we want to predict, so given a person, we want to predict what their status is. And we have some theory behind it. So now a baby is born, and we want to make some prediction. So we have this theory producing probabilities, and we want to to be able to evaluate and use theories like this. And what I want to be able to do, so suppose we have a theory, some source of probabilities. So we have two questions which are dual to each other. If you can answer one of the questions, we can usually answer the second one. So we want to understand, we have this theory, we want to understand what it tells us about reality, so what it predicts about reality. We want to be able to extract some predictions. And we also want to say that some theory contradicts reality, or vice versa. So they are not compatible. So we have some empirical data just shows, tells us this theory is wrong. So we want to have some way of testing theories. So I just wanted to extract these two things So to use this interpretation to answer these two kinds of questions. Let me talk about it using this example of this theory. Okay, so the theory is that the status of the boy given by the status of his parents like this. So the boy can't be the carrier. So the hemophilia is determined by the X chromosome. The boy has just one X chromosome, so he cannot be the carrier. He's either ill or he's healthy, depending on this chromosome. So if one chromosome is taken from the mother, the only X chromosome can be taken from the mother. So the status of the father is not relevant. And here, so if mother is healthy, the boy is definitely healthy. If mother is carrier, so her two chromosomes are different, healthy and ill. So he's healthy with probability 1/2 and ill with probability 1/2. If the mother is ill, which happens very rarely, so the boy is bound to be ill. So he's always ill. Okay, so this is the probability for the boy. So these are predictions of our theory. So a boy is born, and we can make this prediction. So we want to test these probabilities for all boys and all girls, newborn boys and girls. So for a girl, these are the probabilities. So you can it's compatible with the usual idea of inheriting hemophilia. So if father is ill and mother is ill, so the girl is ill, but the girl can be a carrier as well. So the girl gets one X chromosome from the mother and the other from the father. And the mechanism, okay, if father is healthy and mother is ill, for example, we know it's she's going to be a carrier. So different chromosomes. Okay, so you can check any line. Probably the details don't matter. So so does everybody agree with this? So we have some specific predictions. So it's some primitive theory of inheriting hemophilia. So we have these probabilities, and this is all our theory tells us about. Okay, so let me arrange this as a protocol. Probably you've seen examples of such protocols. So now we are just observing our population. So from time to time, boys and girls are born. And this is what is happening. So, and we are trying to test this theory to figure out if it's correct or not, if it contradicts our observations. So we give some prediction for the baby, and then we test the baby. So we can assume that at least for some babies, we learn eventually the hemophilia status. So okay, so we time is discrete here, so n is 1, 2, and so on. So we have a player, so we call it the skeptic. So we have skeptic who's trying to test the theory. Okay, so skeptic, so there is a player reality, and we know something about, the theory tells us something about reality, but not everything. So reality chooses, N1, 2, and so on, so it's so birth number one, birth number two, and so on. So we have this ordered list. So reality chooses the status of the parents, Fn and Mn. So some people decide, two people decide to have a baby. Our theory doesn't tell us anything about who decides, which pair decide to have a baby. It's something that we don't know. Our theory also doesn't tell us anything about the sex of the child. Is it a boy or is it a girl? So you can say it's 50-50, but it's not part of our theory. But then what our theory tells us, we have some, suppose forecaster is somebody who just uses this theory blindly. So it's our theory. Forecaster is our theory. After we know this, Fn, Mn, and Cn, we can compute this probability measure. We can the three probabilities for three different values of the status, H, C, and I, as I described earlier. And now skeptic can gamble against those probabilities. So what skeptic does, announces some function fn such that, so fn maps, so he attaches a number to h, c, and I. So this is the amount of, he starts from $1, and fn is the amount of money he wants to have after the actual status is revealed. So if it's h, he gets fn of h, if c, fn of c, if it's I, fn of I. But for this game to be fair, the expected value of his capital after this trial, it should not exceed kn minus 1. So we allow him to throw away some money. So it's so this integral of fn dpn, it's the weighted average. So it's just we have fn of h times the probability of h, so the probability that is output by our theory, plus step n, plus fn of kj, pn of c, plus fn of il, pn of I. Okay, so this is, we have this this weighted average of all of the values of f, and it should be equal to or below what he already has. So it's a fair game. He starts from 1. The expected value at the next step of fn should be below 1, but he's free to choose any gamble. So fn is his gamble, skeptic's gamble. Then, so he's allowed to gamble repeatedly. And suppose reality announces yn the real status of this.
Based on all the past data or just
No. Here it's enough to have fn, mn, and cn.
So you just use all the information from past. Suppose your step is 100.
Yes.
You use all the data from one.
No, you don't need it.
You don't need
it,
just update
it. So, these are our probabilities. So our probabilities are given by this table. So it is. No, it's, there are no probabilities here. Nothing is independent.
But how do you calculate
PN? PN
based on FN and
Yes, PN is based on FN, MN, and CN.
So
but you don't.
Chart.
Yes, that's right. Yes.
So you don't use
collective.
Okay, so
you don't use it. This is the only thing our theory tells us. It's genetics. And we don't have probabilities for FN, MN, and CN at all. So it's not, there is no stochastic mechanism, overall mechanism. So you can see it's a mixture of uncertainty. There is a lot of uncertainty here. It's not all risk. So here, Fn, Mn, and Cn are chosen. Somehow we don't know how. And after that, we have some probabilities for H, C, and I. Then new F, M, and C are chosen. Again, we have probabilities. So at each step, we have this mixture. So uncertainty interferes at every moment here. But we also have some probability. So it's an open theory. This theory only, it's partly, so only part of the observations are described by probabilities. Okay, so it's, and this happens in a loop. So we do it. Okay, so first, the rules of the game. So skeptic is not allowed to go into debt. So it should be, his capital should always be non-negative. So if k becomes negative, so skeptic loses. The game is stopped. Okay, so this is our game, just to... Okay, Eddie. Okay, so can you give me some line? Let's talk about some specific line.
I was just thinking
of h
equals to 1. How do you write the value?
Oh, OK. So here it says, so there are X chromosomes can be of two kinds. Okay. Some X chromosomes are bad, some are good. Okay. So women have two chromosomes, and men have one X chromosome. So if for a man, if the chromosome is bad, he has hemophilia. If it's good, he doesn't. He's completely healthy.
So you get the population from some underlying
something. Oh, yes, yes, yes. So here you know that father is completely clean. His chromosome, his only chromosome is good. And for mother, she's completely clean. Both chromosomes are good. So the baby is bound to be good. He's healthy, we know. But if, let's look at this or this. So here, it's, this case is more interesting. So the baby can be healthy or casual. So it's a girl. So a girl gets two chromosomes, one from the father, and one of the two chromosomes from the mother. So here, if father is healthy, so one chromosome she gets is good. And from the mother, she's a casual.
Theory, and you aren't too concerned with whether it has been well validated
previously? No. We have this theory. Somebody tells us. We have in a textbook. We have this theory. And we would like to understand what it tells us about the world. So there are two possible questions.
Yeah, but you're not so concerned about how the theory was invented.
No. So what I'm saying is the justification for this theory. But suppose it's just in some book, or somebody tells us, we have this theory. This theory becomes a source of probabilities for us. This is our, so we are not trying to test one probability. We have this source of probability. And we are testing this source. So what I call probabilities on Mars. So just lots of probabilities. And we are testing all of them together. We are not saying that one of these probabilities is wrong. We are just saying that this whole set of probabilities, if it's correct or not. So if skeptic becomes very rich or infinitely rich in some idealized setting, so if skeptic becomes starts from $1 and becomes very rich, then we say the theory doesn't look like it's correct because we can gamble against it. So if we can gamble against the theory, it's not right. We falsified the theory, or almost falsified. OK, so this is our source of probabilities. I'm not sure. Does it answer your question?
See that in this framework, we test theories. You are testing a whole set of probability metrics.
OK, yes, that's right. You have P1, P2, and so on.
So, but then when you write down a theory,
yes.
So you have two questions, dual questions. Maybe it's related. So what is probability? And then the second question is
I didn't understand the first question.
The first question is the fifth line on your slides.
Fifth line? So is it which page is it?
Yeah. So what does probabilistic theory tell us about reality?
Yes.
What is predictions?
Yes.
It does have predictions for each individual event, for the probability of
the
question is about how do you...
No. Here I'm talking about a different kind of predictions.
Okay.
Yes, so my kind of predictions, if you look at this whole theory, it can tell you, for example, the percentage of girls that have hemophilia, provided their parents have hemophilia, is such and such. So the predictions are just some big predictions, not for individual trials, but some... this theory tells you about something about sequences of predictions, these small predictions. So here, I don't mean, so this is not my prediction. So PN, I'm talking about bigger predictions. I will have some examples of such predictions.
When you wrote down the seventh slide,
okay. Here's
a theory, right?
Yes, that's our theory. Yes.
And here we have individual numbers, individual events conditioning on
yes.
some other circumstances.
Yes.
And when I'm testing the theory, I'm going to test a bunch of measures that are different here is the theory. It makes sense. It makes sense that here is probably matter.
But maybe it's just wrong. Maybe it's maybe our mechanism
so
is
intelligibility is different from truth.
That's right, yes. So I'm talking about truth.
Okay. But I was wondering when you say the frequencies probabilities, game theory probabilities are interpreted on mass.
Yes.
You mean the intelligibility rests on you have a collection of probability measures.
Intelligibility?
Right. Something being clear and intelligible.
Yes.
It depends on whether you have a collection of probabilities or only one probability. In the formal case it does make sense. In the other case we have only one probability measure, it does not make sense. In that
okay, I'm not sure what intelligibility is. So it's, yes, our theory should be.
So for example, I have a well-formed formula, 2 plus 1 equals 5. That's intelligible, but it's false, right?
Yeah.
So I can have P of H equals 1 if father is H or mother is H. That can be wildly wrong and mistaken about frequency data.
Yes.
But then this is intelligible.
Yes.
Right? So I think this should make sense, even in the game theory.
Yes, for me, so intelligibility is something that I take for granted. Yes, all theories should be precise, intelligible.
Right, okay. So when you said interpretation of yeah. probabilities on Mars, then I can only understand this by saying the verification of individual probability measure is going to depend on the verification of a class of probability measures.
Yes. I'm trying to test this set of probabilities. My theory. So I have
right.
P1, P2,
right.
P2, and I have, so here I have P1, P2, and so on, my predictions. So suppose I have, I don't know, n predictions, and I have the actual outcome, yn. N is a big number. So do they match this? How do they agree with P? If they, So I would like to answer this question. Do I have any evidence of any deviations from this probabilistic theory? So this is my data, and I'm trying to compare these two.
So that I was misunderstanding the claim earlier. So you're saying it's the verification depends on a class of probability measures. Doesn't make sense.
No, I'm not talking about making sense. It's just, it's not verification. You can't verify. So skeptic can falsify theories. So here, because if skeptic, Kn is a small number, it doesn't mean the theory is correct. Maybe skeptic didn't try hard enough or he was not smart enough.
So
but if K is large, this means something.
So when you say when we interpret a source as a probability, not individual probability, you mean we'll verify, basically.
Interpret for you is just, okay, so it's just some, like in the dictionary, the meaning of words.
Interpretation.
No, it's the meaning.
Interpretation usually means, in philosophy, giving sense or meaning to words.
Oh, not always, Raoul. All kinds of philosophers, I think.
No,
it's,
but then this is an interpretation, right?
Ooh.
So you're saying individual probabilities don't make sense? No, that's not what you mean.
No.
You're saying the truth value of that depends on verification of
the class of probabilities. Okay, so no, it's what, so I have a theory. So it's some syntactic object. So it's written or printed in some book.
Right.
But now I want to understand what it means in reality. So I want just to understand the semantics of theories.
Right.
So I have this theory, what does it tell us about reality? So I want, to me, it sounds like interpretation. I'm not sure. Maybe it's not the way philosophers use it.
Right, right.
But it's
with the meaning and interpretation, that seems very much the notion of, intelligibility, not the notion of truth.
No, I'm talking about, okay, so before I say if it's true, so I want to define what it means for a theory to be false. And to me, it just gives, it's
kind of the verification of criteria in the 60s and 50s that was being rejected by multiple scientists. But, I mean, there could be one prediction of a theory that you have to adopt this one criteria of meaningful probability. That's interesting.
Okay, so it's, I'm not sure if it's, Yes, maybe I'm not using the right words, but is what I mean is clear. Yes, so it's, I have a theory, and I would like to understand what it tells us about reality. So it's when I write it like this, or when I write it like this, it's not quite clear what is how I compare, for example, this to this. But when I know how to compare this, so it seems it's now I know. Okay, so it's some statement about reality, about. So it's not just something written here. We just translated it into reality. So let's. Yes. Yes. So I have, oh, is it here, or is it here?
Well, yeah, it's why it's there.
Yes.
Because KN is kind of mapping between zero and positive
KN, right? Yes, it's FN.
Right, it's FN.
And this is KN.
I'm sorry. Yeah.
Okay. So this is K is.
KN is defined as FN Y, right?
Yes, KN is FN of. Oh, okay.
Right, so FN defined.
Let me see, yes. So in this picture, it's automatic. In some other, yes, thank you. In other protocols, it's important, but here it's automatic. We can ignore this bit.
Okay.
Okay, there will be another protocol where it's. But it's always required for all protocols. But for this, it happens to be redundant. Oh, it's here we define Kn as Fn of Yn, and we already say here Fn maps to zero infinity. Yes, so I wrote it by inertia. Okay, but here we have this. So if K becomes large, it means that these Ys don't fit the theory. Okay, so Kn is the amount of evidence found against the theory, and now so we can talk about two modes of using this protocol. So suppose Kn, so we apply skeptic, or we apply some strategy, or just skeptic place in this protocol. So we have our theory. So it, which can be fixed, this theory of hemophilia, and our data. So what happens if Kn is very large? So there are, so we know that the theory and the data are not compatible. But in some cases, we can trust the data. So in this case, we just observed our data. We trust our experimental results. If Kn is large, then we say that we should reject the theory. The theory contradicts the data, then so we, it's a testing mode. And if you trust the theory, it has been well tested, we found it in some respected book, and Kn is large. But the data, we don't trust the data, it's about the future, what we are going to observe. So here we just say that we don't expect this data to observe this data. So it's prediction mode. So there are two different modes for using this way of falsifying probabilistic theories. Okay, so to me it looks like it's an interpretation of probability because it's some connection between the probabilities and reality. Okay, so now some features of this protocol. So this protocol is open. So it's not, you can't, at least you can't apply Kolmogorov's or measure-theoretic probability cleanly in this case. Because in measure-theoretic probability, every event, so event must be measurable, but usually all the regular, so it's just a technical requirement. So it's, for example, an event, oh, okay. So this event, like Cn is a boy, It's an event, but it doesn't have any probability in this picture or the status of the parent. It's just chosen by reality. So there are lots of observations that don't have any probabilities, but some other observations have probabilities. So I think formally Kolmogorov's axioms of probability are not applicable. You can try and apply them, but in some ways that is not quite clean. You can say, let's attach any probabilities to Cn and Mn and Fn. And then if we find, so we can say there can be some corollaries that don't depend on those arbitrary probabilities, but we still need to attach, just to postulate those arbitrary probabilities. Yes.
Yeah, I'm talking about this notion of open scientific theory.
Yes.
That is still this categorization of two kinds of events or operations. One is probabilized.
Yes.
And the other is unprobabilized, like who mates with whom and the sex of the child.
Yes.
And I was wondering why. One might think this event should be unprobabilized.
They shouldn't be. Our theory just doesn't tell us anything about it. We can have no idea. We don't have. So what we have is base. This is what all we have. So it's, you're talking about some comprehensive theories. But it's.
So it's, in this case, a limitation of the theory itself that it should. But the Kolmogorov axioms assume basically sample space, the algebra of the sample space, that includes also this. I was thinking that you can tweak the algebra structure.
I don't think so, no. It's yes, people.
What you're trying to model and
Kolmogorov. People are doing this, but it's usually it's some. Yes, for it started from Dupp, so he started using sigma algebras just to model the available information. But it's optional, you don't need to do that. So even for things like stopping times or some events measurable with respect to some stopping times, there are other kinds of definition, like more intuitive Galmarino-style definitions. So my impression is that it's still. No.
Like if you're willing to adopt your algebraic structure in response to this situation trying to model, or you're trying to change the sample space.
Right.
So you can suppose you're following this theory, then you use the sample space that only includes things like homophobia instead of children, but not includes things like who mates with whom and sex with child.
But you don't have probability. How do you introduce probabilities?
So you basically impose the algebra.
So,
why would that be impossible?
In the picture that, well, I don't know, I should have the way to answer this question. Yeah. But you're going step by step. You have some Fs that you find out that you didn't have probabilities for. Then you get some things that you have probabilities for. Then you get some more things you don't have probabilities for. So, you can't isolate that into. So the status of engineering statistics, you know, I asked my. So right now, we have, of course, been done in the tech department, linear regression, standard regression. You've got X's and Y's. You have the Y's and the X's. And the X's, you have probabilities for the Y's, you have no probabilities for the X's. So this is the most commonplace thing in stats. But it can't, they don't deal with it. Well, the only way you could. One thing they do is they say, well, let's pretend like all the X's were known in advance. say the values were already known in advance. You learn the values that you were wrong.
Yes, yes, I think it's true. Usually they say it's some unknown constants, the axis.
Yeah.
But it's very narrow. Very often you can observe this like on line x1, y1, x2, y2. So x can depend on previous y. So it's just what is important. You don't, it's best just not to assume anything about axis.
But at least one would do it. Maybe it's not that way. But think about their law where maybe opposite an axis. There's not probability in every event. Yeah. And then what our limitation suggests is just basic conditional probability. We don't know much about conditional probability of various macroscopic events in the world. But still, they do have probability. And when you're modeling, if we're modeling athlete, we're trying, we can give a rough estimate about what probabilities are. That'll be one Kolmogorov I'm going to do it. It shows at least one possible way to do the Kolmogorov estimate. Sorry, Kolmogorovian axioms can be possible to use Kolmogorov testing.
Mm-hmm. No, I don't believe you can model this using a sigma algebra. Did I hear you correctly that every event has some probability? So yeah.
That's the given in the theory.
It's what?
There's one theory called the Mantegna. It's one interpretation of probability.
Okay.
Basically, summary over events. What I do is assigning probability to every proposition that we formulate.
Are those not probabilities that these are unknown probabilities?
They could be an unknown, right?
So, Vologia has a theory for testing probabilities that you can't test them unless you know them. This is the idea of testing them seems to involve knowing them.
But here we just want to test. We don't assume those probabilities even exist. So it's like, I don't know, it's what many people believe it makes sense. So not every probability exists. It's not just it exists, but it's unknown to us. It just doesn't make sense to talk about probabilities. So it's, I don't know, Kolmogorov was writing about it, and many other people. That exists, the existence of probability is a big assumption, even the existence. So here we just don't want to assume that any other probabilities, we don't want to assume they even exist. So we have this very specific theory. We think we understand how hemophilia is inherited, and we don't know anything else. So who mates with whom? So it's, yes, it's there is a lot of poetry written about it. It's art. It's not science. We only want to do with science here. So it's, yes, we have this. So we don't want to depend on this, on how these things are chosen. And it's, okay, so. Yeah, so it's just one of possible protocols. Here we still have probability distributions. So it's not we don't need even probability distributions. So this theory is open in the sense that not every observation is attached, is assigned some probability. Precise in that we have some probability distributions. So later we'll have also examples of some imprecise probabilities that can also be tested. It might be too. Philosophical, you will not like it. But let me give you just some examples of other theories. For example, von Neumann's axioms for non-relativistic quantum mechanics. So I think new theory tends to be open. So in this theory, so he just describes what the results of a measurement is. So we have some particle. So it develops. Its development is completely deterministic. It's governed by the Schrödinger equation. But randomness interferes only when we measure this particle. So it's up to the observer to decide what he measures and when he measures it. So after the measurement, so one of the wave functions of the particle is described by a wave function. It's decomposed into eigenvectors, eigenfunctions, and one of these are chosen with some probabilities given by the theory. The only thing the theory gives us is those eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. In the probabilities determined by the eigenvalues. But when we measure the particle and what observable we measure, it's not described by quantum mechanics. It is described by some other sciences, maybe by psychology. But we can test the theory only the relevant parts of it, what the result of the measurement is. Or even in statistical mechanics, so usually it's described as a completely probabilized theory. But we can also talk about some vessel and it changes its shape, it's controlled. Again, here it's not completely probabilized. Then I might have time to talk briefly about financial markets. So they also provide us with some things. We can test the efficiency of the market. So in statistics, Cox's survival model is also very well known. It's not completely, not all observations have probabilities. But let me give you an example of a theory where we have some imprecise probabilities. So this is an example. So I'll start talking about mathematics and history of game-theoretic probability, some mathematics first. So let me state a simple strong law of large numbers. So here we have some forecaster, somebody who predicts the temperature for tomorrow. And this theory is imprecise. This person, so the temperature, let's suppose that the temperature is normalized in some way. So it's between some known bounds, between minus 1 and 1. So xn is what reality gives us, the temperature on day n. And a forecast is trying to predict the temperature, but it's not a full prediction. So he doesn't give us the full probability distribution on the interval between minus 1 and 1. It's too difficult. So the predictor just gives us one value. So it's his expectation of this temperature. So the value is Pn. It's his expectation of Xn, which is between minus 1 and 1. And it will be clear that Pn should really be between minus 1 and 1. It's against forecaster's interest to give anything else. But it doesn't need to be included in this protocol. But we also have skeptics, somebody who tests these predictions. So when forecaster announces these predictions, he should agree on some way or on some rules how his predictions will be tested. So skeptic is somebody who does the testing. And now one possible interpretation of these forecasts, what forecaster can mean, is that forecaster can mean that we can't gamble successfully against him. So we can imagine that a forecaster often offers for sale tickets that pay Xn, where Xn is the future temperature. And forecaster tells us his expectation for Xn. His expectation is the price he charges for this ticket. So skeptic can buy any number of tickets that will pay Xn for this price, Pn. So in this sense, as Pn is the expectation of Xn. It's a non-probabilistic notion of the expectation. We don't have any probabilities in this picture at all. And so a skeptic decides to buy this number as n of tickets. It can be positive, negative, or zero. And now skeptic starts from capital of one, from $1. And at each step, his capital is increased by his profit from one ticket, xn minus pn, pn is its price, times the number of tickets he bought. So it's the evolution of his capital. And here now it becomes really essential to say that if and when kn becomes negative, skeptic loses the game. Skeptic is not allowed to go into debt. Okay, so and if kn becomes very large, it means the forecast is his predictions are falsified. He's not doing a good job. So this is the way we are testing forecast's prediction. So here, what is important? Pn is not a measure; it's just one number. So it's in this sense, it's an incomplete prediction. So this picture is open. We don't assume that Pn is given by some probability distribution. So there are no probabilities on Pn. So also not everything is here is probabilized. But also for Xn, we don't even have the full probability distribution for Xn. Okay, so it's in this sense it's an imprecise theory. Okay, so now let me state one mathematical result. A type of predictions we can extract from this theory. So the prediction is a prediction about, it's a global prediction about the whole sequence of observations and these local predictions output by a forecaster. So we have the actual temperatures, what reality outputs, Xi. And Pi is our predictions. So one global prediction is just to say that the average deviation of the actual outcomes from these one step ahead predictions by forecaster, this average deviation should tend to zero, as n, the number of trials, the number of days, tends to infinity. So it means predictions are well calibrated. Okay, so how can we state this this statement? So we would, if a forecast is doing a good job, we would expect this to hold. We would expect the predictions to be unbiased in this sense. Okay, so one way to formalize it is to say that skeptic and forecaster are playing this game. So skeptic wins the game if his capital is never negative. He can't go into debt. And one of two things happen. Either this global prediction is satisfied, or his capital becomes infinitely large. So it means that either forecaster does a bad job, we falsify the forecaster, or if he does a good job, then his prediction must be unbiased. So one of these two things. So we have this game. Okay, so we have no probabilities in this game, but this looks like the strong law of large numbers. Yes?
First, two questions about the conditions. First, why do we have to have Kn never negative? Why can't it just be not negative in the limit? I was thinking that the skeptic wins the game if in the limit of n, Kn is not negative.
So in the limit, Kn is... So are you talking about this bit?
I was thinking about the first one. The first one, Kn is never negative. It seems to be a very strong condition.
But still, the theorem tells us skeptic has a winning strategy in this game. So if it's strong, it makes our results stronger.
To say that the way the game is set up, if a skeptic goes into debt, reality can keep him in debt.
So in this case, so reality, what reality can do, just repeat Xn. Okay. So the capital doesn't change. But here also, these So it's what you want here. So one of our goals was to make the usual theorems of probability theory stronger. So we want this theorem, we want our theorem to imply the standard theorem. And if you allow skeptic to go into debt, I'm afraid this will not longer be true. So we have to be, we have to require that skeptic's capital is never negative. So we insist that otherwise, so if skeptic can risk, he can achieve a lot. So it's, yes, this bit I think is essential.
Yes, the second question, just clarification, for the world liberation.
Yes.
I'm a little bit confused because it seems like in that case, the forecaster is doing
No, no, it's not a sufficient condition of doing a good job. It's a corollary of doing a good job. It's the simplest possible corollary. There are lots, so it's well calibrated in a weak sense. Another notion of being well calibrated is that if you only pay attention to days where PN is close to like 0.4. Forecaster tells us the probability of rain is 40%. Then the average value of xn, okay, so it's about temperature. But if you look only at the days, oh no, here it's not so. Oh, okay, we can still say if the temperature is, what it is, it's 50 Fahrenheit. I'm not sure how you write it. But so this is, we are looking only at the days when the prediction is 50. So the average of those days should also be close to 50. So this is a strong, and this should be true for any approximate value of the prediction. This is a stronger notion of calibration. And it will also be implied. You can also substitute instead of this, this stronger notion. Here we just say, on average, the predictor should be doing a good job. But this is very easy to achieve. So, for example, a forecaster can just give some long-term average without paying any attention to this particular day. It's a very, very weak notion. I just wanted to, so you can improve it greatly. But I just wanted to say how you can state this kind of results. Okay, so if there are no other questions. Yes, so we have this theorem. Skeptic has a winning strategy in this game. So either the forecaster is well calibrated or he becomes infinitely rich. The standard interpretation. So we don't expect, if we trust forecaster, then we expect him to be well calibrated. But also, this is applicable also, what I find is strange, to the predictions output by some prediction markets. So very often people can just buy futures on some events. Who will become the next American president? So it's a standard event. You can buy futures, buy something like tickets like this. For this event, but here PN XN is 0 or 1, so it's binary, and PN is a number between 0 and 1. And so if you have this kind of predictions and you observe lots of elections, then so here you can say this theorem tells you that either one of these two things happen. Either you become infinitely rich, you make a killing in this market, or the predictions will be well calibrated. So it's some justification for the wisdom of crowds. For some reason, this crowd of people who are just trading, who might not know much about elections, they predicted correctly on average. So it's no matter. So in prediction markets, you can. Yes, of course, it's extremely idealized. But here it's not clear what you should expect. Why should you expect this? But at least you know that one of these two things will happen. Okay, so, so this connection with measure-theoretic probability. So it was important for us just to prove strong decisions from the mathematical point of view. So it's an example. It's one simple measure-theoretic strong law of large numbers. So we have xi1, xi2, and so on. They're independent random variables. And they have some expected values. But here I'm still assuming that they're between -1 and 1. They are bounded. If there are not, some extra conditions are needed. But if they are bounded, then we can say that the limit of this average deviation of this random variable from its expected value will be 0, almost surely. Now we don't have this qualification, almost surely. But this is a causality of the game theoretic result. So why? So in this case, so we said our protocol was non-stochastic. There were no probabilities in it. But now let's assume that reality does follow some randomized strategy. So reality generates xn from this random variable, xi n. And forecaster chooses pn as a constant. So it's the expected value of xi n. So it's, it can depend on n, but it's the expected value of this xi n. So both are playing these strategies. And now, if skeptic follows his winning strategy, so so kn will be a non-negative martingale. So if you so now we have. Now we have, okay, if you look at the way the capital is evolving, do I have, oh yes, it's here. If you look at the way the capital is evolving, now the picture becomes probabilistic. If you look at the expected value of kn given the past, then Pn is the expected value of xn in this measure-theoretic picture. So the expected value of this is 0. So Pn is a constant. So when we take this expected value, we know everything that happened before xn. We know Pn, Sn, but we don't know xn. So this conditional expected value will be 0. So the expectation of kn will be kn minus 1. We get a martingale. So it's a measure-theoretic martingale, and you can, and it's well known that a non-negative martingale tends to infinity with probability 0. So if you look at this, so it says that either a limit is infinity, the probability of this is 0, it means the probability of this has to be 1. So we have this implication. We get strong results. In the opposite direction, it's not clear how we can extract, how we can transform the measure-theoretic result into this. But, yes?
Just a question about how to understand intuitively.
Yeah.
I usually imagine these games being played, like two players against each other, like skeptic against forecaster.
Yeah.
But this first part of the second line, it seems more cooperative. Like, the skeptic wins if forecaster is well-calibrated.
Yes, so here it's about skeptics, so they're not adversary here. No, it's this doesn't enter even the intuitive picture. Skeptic is just testing or forecaster's moves. Okay, so yes, so we can say that. So the game theoretic strong law of large numbers, we can say that it, so we can restate it. We can introduce some notion of probability. We didn't start from probabilities, but probabilities kind of emerge in this picture. But it's a different kind of probabilities. So we construct probability ceases to be the basic, the fundamental notion. Probabilities are derivative. So we start from the rules of the game, but we still we can, for this new notion of probability, we can say that this holds with lower probability 1. We don't have just probabilities. We have upper and lower probabilities. So if something holds with lower probability 1, it's it's equivalent to its complement holding with upper probability zero. So we expect it to happen. So let me introduce these notions of probability. So suppose we have some event. So event here means just a set. So E is a set of predictions, so moves by forecast and reality. So these are slightly different kind of events as compared with the usual measure-theoretic probability. In measure-theoretic probability, an event is, it's about reality. Here we have reality and forecast as well. So the what is the probability of this event? So the probability is the smallest possible. Oh, okay, so it's the smallest epsilon such that skeptic can start from 1, he never goes into debt, and he gets at least 1 over epsilon when this event E happens. Or you can scale it, you can say he starts from epsilon, and he gets 1 when this event happens. So he wants to, in financial terminology, he wants to super hedge this event. Okay, so we have this notion of probability. So if this probability, this upper probability is small, it means a skeptic can multiply his capital manifold if the event happens. So we don't expect it to happen if it's singled out in advance. Okay, so here I say supremum of Kn, but you can replace it by lim sup or lim inf, you get the same notion of probability, because you can always stop when you reach this level. The lower probability of E is defined like this. It's 1 minus the upper probability of the complement. So if the lower probability of an event is close to 1, we expect it to happen. So often you have up and lower probabilities will coincide in continuous time. Probably you will not have time to reach it, an example of such an event today. But it happens usually only in continuous time. But in discrete time, lots of results tell us that upper probability is close to lower probability. They coincide asymptotically, but not for a finite number of observations. The basic notions are upper and lower probabilities, not just this single notion of probability. Okay, so let me give you an example. Yes?
Well, I was just going to ask, do you know when that inf is witnessed by an actual epsilon? Are there particular conditions under which there is?
Okay, it's attained. Witness, yes, probably you mean something else. So it's witnessed by some strategy.
Yeah, so there is a particular smallest epsilon. It's not just a converging.
Oh, you mean it's attained.
Yeah.
So there is this infimum. You can start from this infimum and get. Okay. So your question is if there are simple criteria for that.
Yeah.
I think it's usually it's yes. Usually it's attained, but it's I don't know any criteria. So maybe we should look for some criteria. But it's, here we are talking, it's about, yes, if it's attained or not in practice, or probably even in philosophy, it shouldn't matter because it's a matter, I don't know, it's hair splitting. So if you add some 1 billionth to your upper probability, why should it matter? But mathematically, I think it's a very interesting question, if it's attained or not. Okay. Yes?
The existence of the strategy is a theorem. Is the strategy always computable?
Oh, yes, that's right. You can't say it's always computable. But all strategies in our book, for example, are computable.
Okay.
So what is good here as compared... So here it's very constructive. In measure-theoretic probability, of course, it's not about strategies. But here it's always explicit. You can write it down. You can see, you can say what skeptics should do. Yes, I should have said it. Yes, it's explicit, constructive, and it's computable, definitely computable. So usually we wanted, okay, so I told you, we have results which say something like, if a game-theoretic result is true, it implies the corresponding measure-theoretic result. But it's true only when we assume that skeptic strategy is measurable. If it's not measurable, then we can't say anything. But in theory, in abstract theory, we never impose this requirement of measurability, because it's awkward. And it's, of course, we want more than measurability. We want computability, which we always have. But in abstract theory, it just doesn't play any role. So in abstract theory, we just say a strategy exists, not even saying it's measurable. But in practice, it is computable for all results we know. OK, so here an example. So here I just apply the strong law of large numbers to this hemophilia game. So just so we don't need to have probabilities assigned to all events, even in this very partial theory. We have this statement. So suppose we observe an infinite number of births when either a boy or a girl is born. So let's assume one is the indicator function. So this antecedent means suppose in our sequence mother is carrier in the mother of a newborn boy is a carrier. So this event happens infinitely often. Then, if it happens infinitely often, then the percentage of times when the boy is healthy is 1/2. If the mother is carrier, it's the two genes. So it was in our table. Yes, it should be. So here it says the probability, some kind of the frequency of healthy boys is 1/2. OK, so here formally I say that this event holds with lower probability 1. Either the number of these cases when a boy is born from a carrier mother, either it's finite, or if it's infinite, it means this frequency is 1/2. OK, so it's a corollary of the strong law of large numbers. So here we don't need to have probabilities for all events. It's still true. So it's either this is true, or skeptic's capital gets infinitely large. We falsify.